At our church, we love God. Make no mistake about that. At our church, we believe Jesus is God. We're not asking you to change your belief system before you attend our church. We're simply inviting you on a journey toward Jesus.
We believe that prayer moves the hand of God, and it's normal for every believer to be intimate with God and devoted to His cause. At our church, we believe the Bible is God's Word. It's real, it's living, and it's active. We believe freedom is the heart of God for every believer, and we value humor, simplicity, teamwork, and a positive outlook on life.
At our church, we're about developing great relationships with God, each other, and those in our community. At our church, we believe that Jesus really lived, that He really died on the cross, and that He really rose again on the third day. And we cannot and will not water down or candy coat that message, ever.
And finally, and most importantly, at our church, we're not concerned about where you've been, but where you're going. We believe that all people matter to God, and therefore matter to us.
Today, you have chosen to sit yourself in the middle of a very safe place to hear a potentially life-changing message. Welcome to our church.
Down at Evansville, which was an awesome time in the Lord. Holy Spirit fell. There's a lady started running around, and you know, it's been a long time since I've seen the Spirit move like that. People were at the altar, laying out at the altar. You know, anymore, it's hard to get one person to come up to the altar, but the whole body there came up, and it was just something to see. You know, it was an amazing time. with that said, Brother Richard's going to bring the word today, so pray for him as before he comes. And I want to just give you five tips. It says for staying young, and this is just good little quotes, you know, to hear. And you know, sometimes when you start getting older, you're like, I'm sorry, I'm just old. And then you look in the mirror, and then you really go, oh boy, I'm old. You're trying to pull up your face. But here's five tips to help you. They even got tape now that you can like pull this back and tape your face up. And I'm like, I was just, you know how you skip around on YouTube and you watch things and stuff like that? This one lady, she was old. She had, I don't know where I got this, but she started pulling her face up and taping it, pulling it up, taping it, pulling it up and taping it. And you couldn't see the tape. It was some kind of special stuff. But by the time she was done, she looked like she was 20 years younger.
It was duct tape, wasn't it?
No, they don't make clear duct tape.
Duct tape fixes everything. What about
the duct tape? That's the wheel.
They even make clothes out
of it. Oh. Yes. Well, anyway, here's one tip. It says your mind is not old. Keep developing it. Keep learning all the time. Your humor is not over. Keep enjoying it. Your strength is not gone. Keep using it. What little bit of strength you got, keep using it. Your opportunities have not vanished. Keep pursuing them. God is not dead. Amen?
Amen.
Keep seeking Him. And that's what we have to do. You feel dry inside? You got to seek Him. And you know what? That takes time. That takes time. Quit being so busy. Quit working so much and quit, you know, doing what hobby or whatever it is that you just love to do all the time, and seek God.
Where'd you find those at?
I'm not telling you. it's called A List to Live By, and it's for every day that really, for things that matter in your life, you know.
Go
you
know, with the feet.
We can choose our attitudes. We can choose our attitudes.
Yeah. Hey, Roxanne, go up and get it real quick, would you? I can keep up with you.
Oh, your mind is not old. Keep developing it. Your humor's not over. Keep enjoying it. You know, laughter is good medicine.
Amen.
The word says, merry heart. Merry heart, me. What is it? I can't remember what. A merry heart does the body good.
Yeah.
And that means if you can laugh at yourself, at others, you know, things that happen in the world, things on TV, it does your body good. You know, laughter.
You said you like gesture, because I've seen that before God.
Yeah, I got to tell, before Bruce comes up and gives a scripture, I got to tell you something that happened. And I'm trying to tell it good, but me and Barb were taking turns driving, you know. And it was Barb's turn to drive. Well, I'm short, and my legs hurt if I'm sitting down low, so I have to have a seat raised up high for me to drive. Well, she went to get in the car, and she didn't move the car seat back and then lower it down first, so she got stuck while she was getting me. She goes, "You're going to have to come and help me. I can't get my head around. I can't get my foot back out." And I started laughing.
Oh, my.
And she started laughing. So I came around, mind you, there was a couple sitting in the car right next to us. And I said, "Barb, I can't see the button." So she had one leg out, one leg in, and she was like this, and her leg was right over where the button was at. And I started laughing, and I said, "Barb, I'm going to have to reach between your legs." And she started laughing really hard, and I was afraid, because I was afraid I'd, you know, hit something. I started laughing. I said, "Barb, if I hit the wrong button, it's going to be a big hallelujah." I mean, we were both laughing so hard, we were in tears. But finally, I hit the right button. I hit the right button, and I got it lowered down. And I said, you know, I said, "This will be a memory that we for the rest of our life." I probably shouldn't have said that or told that in church.
Should have had that on tape.
But it was just one of those fun moments, you know, that you won't ever forget. Well, we laughed on the way home.
People sat next to you, then probably went home and told
you. Oh, yeah. I glanced over there at them, and they were like, "What are they doing?" You know, because they could, to them, they had to look really weird. But anyway, with that said, Bruce, you want to come
sure.
And give us a word?
He can't. The scripture I kind of looked at for this morning, there's nothing new to anybody who's been in church very long. Romans 12:2, it says, "And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is good and acceptable and perfect will of God." You know, with all the things going on around us in the world, you know, the world tries to get anybody that doesn't believe the way they do to accept their ways, to mold you into what they are. You know, that's why they try to get Christian preachers to marry gay people and things like that. And there's a lot of people out there who would be glad to marry them, but you know, they go pick on somebody that doesn't believe like they believe. You know, God's given us all a choice, but I think, you know, the way we live in the world that we're in today is to transform our mind to know what the Word says and to live accordingly.
Yeah.
And it's not looked upon favorably by a lot of the people anymore, but truthfully, you have to remember that this Word is truth, and it is life. And that's what we live by, and it's really good for us. I mean, it is joyous and it is fun. God, like I said, you know, another scripture I thought about when you're talking about laughing, I think there's a scripture that says laughter strengthens the bones.
Yeah.
And think about that. You know, God expects us to have a good time. Now, that doesn't mean that there aren't some ups and downs and there aren't some trials and tribulations that He tests us through. But when we come out the other side, it says we're purified and we're strengthened. So, like I said, you know, transform your mind. You got to get in this Word. You got to read it. You got to study it and know what it says so that you can have faith in it. You know, I had to tell Roxanne before church, Jesus said when He went around healing people, but what He did first was He preached to them. Mm-hmm. They had to know the Word before they had something to have faith in, to believe in them. So He had to preach to them first before they could have faith to receive the healing.
Yeah, yeah.
And because that's the only way we receive anything from God,
yeah,
is through faith.
Yeah.
So anyway, transform your mind. Don't be conformed to what's around you. It's the way everybody else is living. Don't live like they do.
Right.
It's not what God wants, you know. And he tells us that don't think you're foolish when you live according to this Bible. But we know when it's all said and done, who wins?
Amen.
It does, the church.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Well, I have a new song this morning. It may not be new. It's called I've Been Changed, and it's kind of upbeat. And so I hope you can keep up.
Let me tell you, oh my friend, about this joy I'm living in. Let me take the mic, go on and testify how I was dead and then I came to life. No more living in the dark of night. Now everything's alright. I've been changed.
Yeah.
can feel the joy on the horizon. Here my faith is found. I stand on solid ground. When I feel my hope about to break, I will cling to your unchanging grace. Let the waters come and the earth give way. A solid rock I stand, all of the ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands, our feet are on the rock. On Christ a solid rock I stand, all of the ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands, our feet are on the rock. On Christ a solid rock I stand, all of the ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands, our feet are on the rock. Then I feel my heart.
Waters come and the earth give way. I'll be dancing in the rain. When I feel my hope cross as you wait for the crown. Tell the world of the treasure you found.
That needs to just be loved on by you. You know, we don't have to preach at people. We need to just give them love. That's what Jesus did. Give them love. Again, the Lord bless us in this morning for someone to slow down. You know, life sometimes takes us in different directions, and we get so busy that we forget to seek Him and ask, am I supposed to be doing this? Is this what you want, God? Or is this what I want? Or is this what somebody has said I should do? Or sometimes we let people affect us in our decisions, don't we? Well, it might not be what God really wants. So we need to do that. And you know, and I'm guilty. I really am guilty of that myself. We need to seek God and find out if that's what God wants us to be putting our hands to. So with that said, Brother Richard, Barry, however, whatever, you. Come on up here. And you can wear this mic or this mic, whatever you want. But we need you to be on the mic so it will pick up on our CD. So either one. I just don't know which one you want to use.
I'll use one. I'll walk too much.
Okay, this one?
Yeah.
This one? Or this
one?
That one. Okay. I'll fix you up.
Good morning. Sometimes we think that we shouldn't do things like that, but we should laugh about stuff like that. We should talk about it. It happened. Amen. You know, nothing wrong with it whatsoever. Besides that, I like a good story. My grandson back there one time, I told him a little thing, and he wrote a paper on it. He said that's the first day he ever got. So, telling stories is what I do best. I was telling the sister and brother a while ago, I can't sing a lick. I couldn't sing if they had five guys holding the bucket. I still wouldn't sound good. I can't poetry because my voice just ain't that good. I said the only thing God gave me that I could use for Him was a big mouth. And I don't think there's anything wrong with having a big mouth. I want people to hear what I have to say.
Amen.
About the Bible.
Amen.
Now, I'm not here today to lift up Richard Walsh. Now, some of them back there calls me Gary, some of them calls me Richard. It doesn't matter.
I'm a child of the King. That's what matters.
Yeah.
What my name is don't count to me whatsoever. But the thing of it is, and I like to tell this to churches I preach in, I don't come today preaching denomination. I simply preach salvation.
Amen.
I'm not come today to lift up Richard, Gary, or whatever you want to call me. I'm not here to glorify his name. You know, you tell somebody you're from Kentucky, your IQ automatically drops about 5 points. And that's a fact. They begin to think that you're pretty stupid. You know, we walk around barefooted and we live in houses with no floors in them. Well, I've never lived in one of those houses. I have walked around barefooted. But the point I'm trying to make is, I don't care how dumb you think I am. As the old saying goes, I don't care if people think I'm as dumb as a box of rocks, as long as I know Jesus Christ.
That's right.
That's the only thing that matters
Amen.
In my life.
Amen.
And I'm not here to glorify Amen. Me. If you get anything out of what I say today, I want you to thank God for it. Not me, God. Because today, God preaches the Bible, not me. He just uses me as a tool, just like we use a car to get here. Like Brother Mike uses a hammer to rob the church. I'm just a tool that God uses, and I let him use me, and therefore I'm a child of the King, and I'm going to go to heaven.
Amen.
Death and hell and the grave has no power over me whatsoever. Because I know a man called Jesus. Now that ain't even what I'm going to do, some people. But as we read this, and I know some people say, well, that's not the way you pronounce that. Or that's not the way you pronounce it. I don't care how you pronounce it. I ain't preaching on the word. I'm preaching on Jesus Christ's word, not how I pronounce something.
Yeah.
And if I pronounce it wrong, you pronounce it your way. Just listen to what God has to say. All right, in John 4, starting at the first verse, it says, then therefore the Lord knew how the Pharisee had heard that Jesus had baptized more disciples than John, though Jesus himself baptized not, but his disciples. He left Judea and departed again into Galilee. Now this is the part that I'm going to stop at, and I'm going to tell you how I read this. And this is the part I like about this whole thing. And he must need go through Samaria. Not that he's going to stagger through there accidentally. He need to go through
Samaria. Amen. He needed to go through.
So let's pray, and then we'll try to get through this. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for everyone that's here. We thank you, Lord, for thy Son that died for us. We thank you, Father, for the Word of God that you gave us. We thank you, Father, that you preach today. You give us the words, we'll relay it on to your people. And Father, we pray, if there's anyone here that is lost, as Jesus told the woman, if you'd ask me, I'd give you living water. If they need the living water today, let them come and take a drink of it, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
First of all, this is going to be odd to me. I want everybody to stand, just look at each other. Say good morning, hello, or God bless you. I don't care what you say, just look at each other.
Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Hello there, sir. Good morning. God bless you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. God bless you.
Good morning.
Good morning. God bless you.
Good morning.
God bless you.
Good
morning.
Good morning.
All right, folks. I'm ready to go now.
Hey, man.
I'm a little bit nice.
That's good. Didn't tell you couldn't be seen to go
there. We get to sit down there all day.
I'm going to be happy, brother.
Well, hey, Mrs. Nettles.
We get to sit down, we gotta wait till you tell us to.
You can sit down anytime you want to. I just wanted to say, I just wanted to do this to you.
Yeah.
You know, how many times have you been asked, show us Jesus? Let us look at him. I just showed him to you. If we're a child of God, if we're a child of the King, and we belong to Jesus, he said our life and our beginning should project him. When Jesus, and they asked him, said, show me God. He says, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. If you've seen us, and we're living a Christian life, you've seen Christ. That's what the Bible said. I didn't make this up. The Bible says this. So today I just wanted to show everybody Christ. Because we see it in each other. He said, because the reason you can see God in him, the Father, he said, because I come to do the work of my Father. And if we do the work of Jesus, which is the Word of God, which is God, then we can see Jesus in each other's life.
Amen.
And if we can, we better get down on our knees somewhere and begin to pray so they can see Jesus in our life.
Yes.
Amen.
Yep.
Now this little woman here, she was an outcast even from the Jews, outcast from her own family, outcast from her own people. Nobody wanted her. Nobody liked her. Why? Because she'd been married 5 times. And the man she lived with wasn't hers. And she was pretty well at the end of her rope. She was coming to the well in the middle of the day when it was hot because she didn't want to put up with the other women making fun of her. Because the Bible says they did. They made fun of her, didn't think she had any morals about her at all because of what she did. You know, the Bible says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. You know, this woman paid for her sins while she was still walking on the earth. Now, I know there's a payment of sin in hell when you die. But this woman was paying for her sins here. Because she had no friends. She had nobody to talk to. Can you imagine a whole town that just didn't want to talk to you? And all you had was the guy you lived with. Can you imagine not having anyone? You know, these women, this well was an important, if you read the Bible all through the Old Testament, you know, like a well was very important to these people.
Yes, it was.
It was the only place that he was. You know, they drove their herds for miles and brought them to this well just so they could draw water and water them. No doubt they made business deals at this well. No matter, these women came because it was the highlight of their day to come to this well and stand there and talk and maybe trade recipes and talk about their children. And fellas, I got news for you. You know they talked about their husband. You don't even have to guess that, do you? You know they talked about it. This was a watering hole, in other words, for people to come. You know this church here today is a watering hole. A spiritual one. If you're here today and you're like she was and you want a drink of water, you can get it today. All you got to do is ask for it.
Yeah.
I want you to notice when Jesus Christ went to that well, and it said he must go to that place, and he was there, and she came. I want you to know something. He did not point his finger and yell there and say, you have been lost, you're a sinner, and you need to be saved because look what your life is. No, he didn't. He started a casual conversation and just simply asked her, give me a drink.
Yeah.
Sometimes as Christians, we get overzealous and we begin to run away people out of the church and still bring them in because we don't know when to shut our mouth. True? And I'm one of them sometimes. But the fact remains is he came to the well and he said to her, give me the drink. Now the surprising part about the whole thing is here was a woman who was an outcast from the Jews, outcast from her own people, and she came to the well and he said, and the Jews had no dealings with Samaria. Matter of fact, they would cross Jordan River and go plumb on the other side and get so close to where they was going and cross back because they hated them and despised the Samaritans that bad. But here was a man who was a Jew was saying to her, give me a drink. I want a drink of water, so give me one. And she says, why would you ask me to drink? You're a Samaritan person. Or you're a Jew and I'm a Samaritan. Why would you ask me? They don't have no dealings with us. We don't even talk to each other. And you're asking me for water? You know what this whole story seems to be about? Is how much love that Jesus had for one person.
Yes, that's right.
See, we look at this little church here. We look at this little church here and we think, well, here ain't got many people coming. Nobody wants to come here because it's not big enough, maybe. Or maybe they don't have the big preachers. But the fact of it is, he went for one person.
Right.
If one person comes to the well, and this well here, the spiritual well, and gets a drink of water, I don't care if we go the rest of our life and never have nobody, it'd be worth that one person. That's what Jesus was saying. But you see, I want to show you something about that one person. When she came to him and he said, I would give you living water. Then he went on to talk about how deep the well was and he had nothing to draw with and how would he give it to her. And he began to tell her, well, you know, if you had known who I am, you would have asked me of water, and I would have gave you living water.
That's right.
That would spring up in you
to
eternal life. Eternal life. Not just this life we have here, but a life beyond the grave. We look at the Bible, we look at things naturally. You know, this was just after he talked to Nicodemus. And Nicodemus said, well, now, Lord, how in the world can I be born and enter into the second time into my mother's womb to be born again? And Jesus said, you must be born again. And he also told him, said, if I tell you natural things or earthly things that you don't understand, how can I tell you spiritual things that you understand? So how in the world was he getting across to this woman? He had a conversation with her. Not yelling, not screaming, but he had a conversation with her. And he kept telling her, you know, when she said, Lord, I perceive that you are a prophet, and she kept talking to him, and he finally told her, this is the only place I believe he flat out come out and said who he was. Mm-hmm. This is the only place that you can find about the woman of Samaria at the well is in John 4.
Right.
Why? Because it's in verse. You know that the pastor here, the assistant pastor back there, me, I could preach on this for a month, he could preach on it for a month, she could preach on it for a month, and we still scratch the surface.
Yeah.
Just scratch a little bit of it. We still didn't get it all said.
No.
We're not getting it all said because there was a lot here. That woman was lost. She was lost and had nobody to help her at all. And Jesus knew. I want you to know something. That woman came to the well to draw water. She didn't come for Jesus. She wasn't seeking Jesus. Jesus was seeking her.
That's right. Yeah. Amen.
Jesus began to seek her.
Yeah.
You know, one time when I was a young man, I was lost and undone. And I went to a little house over here on the south side, about 2 floors from here, to listen at a group of singers that sung gospel to practice. And as I was sitting against a wall down on my feet and I was listening to him, I got saved.
Amen.
Now, I didn't go there looking for him, but he was there.
Yeah.
He came to me.
Right.
If you're here today and you're lost and don't know what to do, come to him and he will talk to you and explain to you just like he did the woman.
Yeah.
He'll give you a drink of water that you won't believe.
Yeah.
This here in the spiritual well. This is where you can get a drink of life. Give you water. I'm going to show you something else. And this is just something that I want to show you. We talk about the tree of life. Now, don't get me wrong before you get excited here. I know the tree of life is that it was in the garden. I know the tree of life, the Bible says, is in heaven, on either side of the river and in the midst. I know all that. But for you and I, the tree of life is Jesus Christ.
That's right.
We have no life without Him.
That's right.
The tree of life is Jesus Christ, because He said there's no other way under heaven a man or woman can be saved except by Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You can't fake it. You can't serve somebody else, because He says you can't serve two masters. You'll either love one and hate the other.
Mm-hmm.
Ain't that what the Bible says?
Yep.
I didn't write this. Jesus wrote it.
It's not other gods. It's not, you know, some ministers say that you can get to Jesus, or you can get to God all kinds of ways, but you can't. It's only through Jesus Christ, not Buddha. It's not Jesus Christ.
That's why it ain't Buddha's name in there. It says there's no other name under heaven that can be saved. You can be saved by except Jesus Christ. Now, He become our tree of life spiritually because He died for us on that cross.
That's right.
So He is our tree of life.
Yeah.
If you don't have Jesus in your life, you have no life. The Bible says if you don't have Christ, you're dead unto God. The only way to become alive unto God, Jesus plainly states it, you must come by Him. The only way you can get to Jesus is God draws you. The only way you can get to God is when you get accepted by Jesus. That's what the Bible says. So if you're here today and you don't know Jesus, you can get to know Him real easy. It's not hard. Just ask Him. That's what she did. Finally, when he got down there, she said, "Lord, give me this living water that I don't have to come here anymore to draw water, or I'll never thirst again." And then when he said, that's what he did. Some people said, "Well, what happened to her?" She said, he said, "Go call your husband. I don't have one. Don't have no husband." Now, she could have lied to him, thought he was a stranger. But she confessed her sins to him. She said, "I don't have one." Jesus told her, said, "You well said. You have no husband. You've had five, and the one you got now." And the way I read it sometimes, the way I'm thinking is the one she had, somebody else's. Because you said that the one you have now is not your husband. Well, evidently, somebody else had it. But the truth of it is, she was worth saving. Jesus, being a Jew, traveled to that well and started a conversation with that woman and said to her, "I'll give you a drink of the him a Jew." Listen to this. She was worth, none of them had a dealings with each other. But here was a Jew saying to a Samaritan, "I'll give you some living water that you don't have to come here." And when the disciples showed up and she left that well, you notice the Bible said she left her water pot there and she brought to get water in? You know why she done that? That water pot couldn't hold the water she had now. That water pot was enough for the vessel. It couldn't hold what Christ gave her. It took something else. Because the only place that Jesus Christ dwells, the only place the Spirit of God dwells, is in a human being. Is in a human being. It's when you ask God to come into your life. You know, there's many places that you can go. They call a lot of places water holes. They even call caverns water holes sometimes. But the real fact of it is, when these people had the water, they had to go to a well somewhere, and they had to dry their, matter of fact, a lot of them met their wives, met their husbands at a well. But I know the reason they went there was, the women went there, they wanted to talk. And they got a chance to talk to different people. Now you go to Walmart.
Yeah.
Now you go to Walmart. Let me tell you something. The only spiritual water you're going to get is from Christ. The rest of them wells don't matter. Walmart don't matter. Kmart don't matter. Well, if they did, they would have closed them all again. But the fact of it is, the only place you can get Jesus Christ is ask Him. You know why this Bible says the bread of life is this book right here? The living water is this book right here? because he said you must eat of my flesh and drink of my blood to have life in you. Why? This Bible, according to John 1st, talks about how the Bible was made flesh, and he dwelt among us as the only begotten Son of the Father, that we should believe in him, full of life, full of eternal life. The only way. This Bible here is the Word of God. It's the water from God.
Yeah.
It's everything. This here is everything you need. You don't need nothing else but this right here. And he'll guide you in the way that God wants you to go. He'll tell you how to get there. And you know, you got stop signs, and we got stop signs that tell us when to stop. We got signs that tell us when to turn left. We got signal lights on our cars to tell other people we're going to turn. This has got all that too. When we're doing something wrong, it's got a stop sign in there and say, hey, buddy, you better quit that.
No.
And when we're getting off the path, it's also got in here to tell us, hey, you're getting a little off the path, you better get back on it.
Yeah.
Why? Jesus don't want nobody to be lost. God don't want nobody to be lost yet. That ain't why he made us.
Yeah.
He made us for the glory of God. Yeah. We just don't give him too much anymore. He made us that we might be a child of God. Why? He loves us. He loved that woman he with me. He showed a woman, a Samaritan that nobody liked. That people put her down, thought she was not even a moral person. But he told her that she was. He showed her love when he went there and talked to her. He showed her compassion when he went there and talked to her. He showed her that he loved her and he would forgive her when he went all that way for one person. But I want to show you something. He went all that way for one person.
Yeah.
We talked about that. But when he got through with her, she went back to the man and began to tell him, come see a man that told me everything I've ever did. Is not this the Messiah? Jesus already told her. Because she said to him, when Jesus was talking to her, I know, Lord, that the Messiah's coming, and he will learn us and teach us all things. That's when Jesus said, that you talk to right now, I'm him. I'm that guy. I am the Messiah. And then when she went back, and there was only one person, I want you to get this. There's one person that Christ talked to. One person that he explained what the living water was. One person that he told her, if you ask of me, I would have gave you living water and it would have sprung up into you as a fountain, in other words, as a spring that would never run dry. You would never need no more water. Because this would take care of you forever. But now, one person went back into that town and told that man what she had seen and talked to and done and said, come see. Ain't this you? Ain't this what we've been waiting for? Ain't this the Messiah? Ain't this Christ?
Yeah.
And the Bible said, because this, all those churches that says women can't do anything in church, they ain't read this book.
That's right. That's right.
Because the Bible said when she went back into that town and began to tell them what she had seen and heard from Jesus Christ, they said they began to believe on him, and they come out of the town to meet him, and they believed more on him because of his word. But one person started the whole thing.
That's right, and she was a woman.
If one person comes to this church and gets saved and gets out in their world and begin to tell them what happened to them, there'll be more. Whether they come here or not, there'll be more saved. That's what Jesus is trying to get across in this story. It only takes one person. Almost the whole town was saved just because she went back into that town and told them, come see a man that told me everything I've done. Come see a man that gave me some water. Now this was the same woman that they didn't like. This was the same woman that the women didn't talk to. This was the same woman that came in the middle of the day, didn't eat, because she didn't want nobody around her. Matter of fact, she herself thought there was no redeeming quality in her because of what she did. But Jesus came with love, understanding, and compassion in his heart to tell her she was worth something. Just because you've done something in your life that you don't think you're worthy of God, you're wrong. Simple fact. I can't put it in another place because I've always told people I don't have no $5 words for nobody. I'm an old boy from Kentucky. And all I use is very simple words. But I want you to understand, this woman, the same woman that they didn't like, the same woman that they ridiculed, went back into that town and began to testify for God. Began to tell them what this man had done. He told me everything I did. Now some people, a person of God, would tell them what they did. They'd tell them to keep their mouth shut, he wasn't none of the business, and leave. But see, he told it so lovingly and so truthfully that she didn't mind it a bit. She went back into that town and she began to tell them. And the people came out and heard God. You know the difference between, I thought about this today, the difference between this time, that town came out and wanted him to stay with them. They didn't want him to leave. Now listen, he was a Jew that they hated. They were supposed to be hated by Jews. And here he was, and they come out and want him to stay. You remember when he cast the devils out of the legion? They said, we are legion because we're so many, and he put them in. And they went in, he said, get us to go into the swine. He put them in there. They drowned it in the lake. They went down. They couldn't even stand that many devils. How could a human stand seven devils when the hogs couldn't?
Yeah.
That's a fact. They couldn't. They went down and choked herself in the water. But the thing I want to tell you is the Pharisees, the leaders and stuff came out, and they were so afraid of him, they asked him to leave. These Samaritans asked him to stay. That's what you got to do to accept Jesus, is ask him to stay,
yeah.
Not to leave.
Good.
Because I'll tell you what, he'll do just like he did then. When they asked him to leave, he left.
Mm-hmm.
Samaritans asked him to stay, he stayed.
Yeah.
If he's dealing with you today, and you know it, I want to tell you this. There's no shame in coming up here and accepting God.
Amen.
The shame is if you don't know him.
Mm-hmm.
That's the shame. Because everything you have today, I don't care what it is, everything that you have, whether you be of God, whether you're a Christian, or whether you're a sinner, God gave it to you.
Amen.
Because he created it all. Only thing that Satan ever created for anybody was sin and trouble. God said he was a liar and the truth wasn't in him. Said he was the father of a liar. He invented a liar. So, we don't want to follow him. Because there is a payment coming that you'll have to make someday.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I've said this before, and I'll say it again. If they wasn't a heaven to go to, and they wasn't a hell to shine, I still want to live the way I am. I like it better this way.
Yeah.
I like living and helping people. I like knowing that people, now don't get me wrong, I've always been, like to help people and stuff now, but there have been times that I've been pretty mean in my life. And this is keep coming up in my mind, and I'm going to tell this and then I'll hush. I've been arguing with God ever since he gave me this message. Of course, now what happens to me is, sister, when she pastor, she has to have something to say every Sunday. But see, me, when God, when I preach, I'll leave here, and it might be a long time before I preach again. So God will give me a message, and I'll search that message, and I'll read something in the Bible, and then I'll go back and search that message, and then I'll read in the Bible. And I'm sitting at the table, and I'm sitting there, and I'm thinking, Lord, what kind of story would go with this? And Bruce, I want to let you know, you're the guy that made me realize when God gives me something, I'm just going to have to say it.
Yeah.
And it popped in my head, Rudolph. And I'm thinking, Lord, I ain't getting in no church or preaching about Rudolph. That's a cartoon. I'm not going to do it. And he says, but the story of Rudolph is a great story. And I'm saying, nope, not going to do it. It's a cartoon. And you know, for after that, Brother Bruce brought up Rudolph twice in two different messages. So I said, Lord, I guess I'll do it then. But the message he gave me about Rudolph was this. He was a deer that was born with a, well, you might say a disability. He wasn't like everybody else. And they put him down for it. Matter of fact, as the story goes, they wouldn't even let him play in reindeer games. They put him down because he was different. They were putting this woman down because she was different. But finally, when it came a storm that they couldn't even see through, they thought of Rudolph. Ain't that the way it is in the world today?
Yeah.
You don't think of them much about so-and-so until you need him, and then you think of him.
Yeah.
When Jesus gave her that water, and the fact of it is, she went back and she began to testify to them and tell them about Jesus. What happened? They started believing in her.
That's right.
The same woman that they abused, more or less, didn't want to talk to her. Didn't want to have nothing to do with her. Well, they were listening to her. What changed? Jesus changed her. They saw just what I said a while ago. When you get up and look at each other, they saw Jesus in her. They began to listen. And that's the greatest story that you can ever find. People listen to Jesus.
Yeah.
And that's what they did. And they began to believe in Jesus. They went out and heard his word. And more believed in Jesus. Why? One woman. Jesus saved at that well. One woman came and wanted the water and stuff. When he told her, he says, she said to him, said, we worship in the mountain. The Jews say we should worship in the city. He said, he told her then, he said, there's coming a time when neither in this mountain will you have to worship God, neither in Jerusalem. Why? Because he was telling her about his death. He was telling her, because there's come a time that curtain that you have to take them sacrifice to the high priest and he goes behind her and sacrifice for you will no longer be there. Because when he died, he said the curtain was ripped from the top to the bottom, and he said that we can go into the holiest of holies now because we're saved and Jesus lives here, not behind the curtain. He don't live behind the curtain. He ain't hiding from nobody.
Yes,
but he wants us, this country, to say yes to him. And today, this church is a spiritual well that you can get that drink. I would like to invite anybody that don't know the Lord Jesus Christ, or does know him kind of off a little bit, you know. The wheels ain't quite turned right. Come on up and pray to God. And you don't want to do it that way. Now, like I said, if you feel like you're too shameful to come up here in front of people and to pray, I want to tell you this. You ought to be shameful more about walking in this world without God.
Yeah.
That's where the shame should come in, not here. And I know that a lot of people don't want to believe the Bible. I know that. You know why people don't want to believe the Bible? The Bible says because their deeds are evil.
Yeah.
So I'm asking you today, if you want to, before I let the pastor have the whole church back, I want you to know you can meet Jesus at the well today. I want you to know you can have a drink of that life-giving water today. You know, I think about that sower of seeds, and I think, Lord, we sow seeds all the time. We tell people about God all the time, and the seed goes out there. But too many of them fall by the wayside. Too many of them fall on rocks, hardness of heart. Because the seed that's got to hit the heart has to be able to grow. And Satan ain't going to let it grow if he can stop it. So the seeds that we are to sow, and I hope I'm sowing enough of them in my lifetime. And you know, I planted a field out there by my house for deer to eat. And I planted a lot of seeds because I know some of them weren't going to make it. A lot of them weren't going to make it. They're going to die off. So today, I want you to know I'm trying to spread as much seed of the Word of God, because the Bible said the seed is the Word of God. I'm trying to plant as many seeds as I can. In case some of them dies, there'll still be a few left. And that's what we got to do. Does anyone want to come and pray to God and ask Him for a drink of water can? And them that don't, we'll pray for you anyway. You ain't going to get away. Amen. Sis, you want to come in?
Amen.
Good to pretend that you know the Lord is sitting in the seat, because it doesn't. You can hide that from me and Brother Bruce and the rest. Can't hide it from God. She didn't hide hers from God. Listen, there's a lot more in there. But I've already been up here too long.
Dear,
but there's a lot more in there. One of these days I might bring another one from that same scripture. So as she comes, as the song plays, anybody wants to come, come on up and pray. It won't hurt you.
Nope.
Might help you a little.
Amen.
Even if you're a Christian, come up and pray if you want to. It don't matter.
Mm-hmm.
Great stuff.